Ayn Rand, and we're talking about her and her philosophy, her writings, and this is to do really grave injustice to a person of such depth and insight. So we're going to try our best, poor as it is, to at least expose those of you who haven't had a chance to read her work to where she stands philosophically and what her philosophies are, what her philosophy is. Okay, how do we start? You don't like altruists.
I disapprove of them. I regard them as evil.
Do-gooders. Lord, save me from the do-gooders.
I don't like those popular expressions.
Oh, okay.
That's too narrow and too political.
Okay, but what's bad about the person who wants to help other people?
Well, to begin with, that's the big mistake. People can want to help other people properly and with very good reasons. But that isn't altruism. Altruism doesn't mean merely helping people. It means sacrificing yourself to others. Placing the interests of others above your own is the self-sacrificing person who is an altruist.
And what's wrong with that?
What's wrong with committing suicide? What's wrong with giving up life? And why is the happiness of another person important and good, but not your own? Why are you always the outsider and the sacrificial animal?
Mm-hmm.
For a good relationship, there should be no victims, no sacrifices.
Okay, so that in a relationship, for example, a man and woman, will talk about the heterosexual world for a moment. To sacrifice for your loved one is, in many cases, then a misnomer. What you're really doing
That's
is
right.
Tell me what you mean.
What I mean by sacrifice. And what is generally meant is to give up some value which is important to you for something else which is a lesser value or a non-value.
That's
sacrifice.
And you don't approve of that?
No, I don't. Now, if you love your husband or wife and you have to, let us say, select between spending money for your spouse if he's ill or going to a nightclub. It's not a sacrifice to spend money for your spouse if he or she is your value. That is what you want to do.
I see.
But if you let, for instance, your husband die in order to save the neighbor's husband or your wife, that would be altruism. If you reject or pass up something which is, or someone who is valuable to you, mm-hmm. and in favor of somebody who is a neutral stranger or even worse, an enemy. If you sacrifice a friend for an enemy, that's altruism. And the issue there is simply watch the hierarchy of values. If something that is important to you requires a great deal of effort from you, that's not sacrifice. But if you give up your career because you want your competitor or rival to be more successful, that would be a hideous and very evil sacrifice.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to figure out how this applies to everyday, if your wife wants you to go to the A&P and you don't want to go, but you sacrifice because it's for the good of the family, is that okay with you?
Perfectly okay.
But what if you're filled with resentment as you go, wondering why, how come you're always the...
Oh, well, if that's true, that it's unfair, and if it's not your understanding with your husband, but he imposes this on you, then it's perfectly all right to resent it, and properly you should raise the issue and decide what you want to do.
Yeah. Well, I don't understand why this is important. What are the consequences of the traditional notion that we've got here in the Western world that sacrifice is what love is all about?
Do you want the quickest example that comes to my mind? The newest proposals of having special millions spent of subnormal children and on the handicapped, including those so-called kneeling buses. It's the attempt to bring everybody to the level of the handicapped. And if it's merely an issue of a physical handicap like a broken leg, or, which doesn't affect the mind, that would be a little more excusable. So I don't believe that such privileges should be granted to any group. But it includes the mentally retarded, which is the subnormal, the children who are unable to learn. So that at the end of spending thousands or millions of taxpayers' money, you're left with a half-idiot who may learn to read and write, may. On the other hand, there are no special schools, or very, very few, for gifted children. And to pass up the gifted, on whom all our lives depend, if it weren't for intelligent people, well, read Atlas Shrugged, what would happen to us without the better mind, who are able to survive and who carry the weight of everybody else? Yet we don't spend any money on them. We do everything.
Well, there's the applause is for your call for more society energy directed at the accommodation of gifted people.
I hope so.
Okay.
But not government spending. However, so long as you support the ungifted, you owe your first priorities to the gifted.
But what in the Ayn Rand civil context would be appropriate societal measures to accommodate the ungifted?
Their own parents. And a chance to give their parents to earn money. If, however, their parents are poor and cannot assume it, it's a big, heavy burden, then you can appeal to private charity, as it was always done before welfare statism in this country.
You want private charity as well for the gifted?
If necessary. They usually, in a free society, they won't need it. They'll make their own way, just so you don't stop them. But private charity cannot be done by means of tax collection, which means by force. Mm-hmm. Private charity is up to you, and if it's a worthy cause, that is, let's say, a subnormal child who certainly cannot help it, it's perfectly all right to help him, but not at the sacrifice of your own child.
You probably like to get rid of HEW then.
Oh, certainly. Oh, well, certainly. Much more than that. I'd like to get rid of.
A lot of the government, huh?
Everything except the basic duties of the government, which is police, law courts, armed forces.
You want less government.
Thank you.
Well, everybody says that. It's a little hard to put that into effect when we've got a country that has such a maldistribution of wealth. You give me that, huh? Too few rich, too many poor.
I will give you part of that, because if there is a maldistribution, it's to those who have political pull. If some of your money is made with government help and government favoritism, then I grant you that is unfair and improper and unjust. But if you made it yourself, in free competition, enough people want to pay you for your services or your product, then you should keep all of it. Why shouldn't you? You made it.
All right. Okay.
You
also think if the Middle Eastern countries want to charge, hold us up for the oil at $5 a barrel, or a gallon, excuse me, $5, will that day ever be bad? They ought to be able to do it. It's their oil. Is that your point?
No. My point is we should not have permitted altruistically to all those nations to nationalize what we built for them. They could...